Special day today. It's John's birthday.
And who are you?
I'm Baha'ud'din. So it's just 2 days that we arrived in Australia, and all this thing just suddenly propped up. And just last year when John heard me in India at a concert, and he asked me if I would like to come to Australia, I said yeah immediately. Found myself saying yes. So everything worked out for the best, and we're here.
Welcome.
Thank you. We come from a very old tradition in India. This music that you're going to listen to tonight is the mother of Indian classical music. It hails from 1500 BC, when the Aryans came to India. They came with the Vedas, and one of the Vedas were the ones which they chanted, Samved, and from that came a form of music which was called Prabhand, and from that it modified itself into a form called Drupad. That's what we're going to listen to today. Dhruva means like there's a star, the north star, it's called Dhruva, and Pad is like composition. It is fixed in its own manner, it moves, but it's steady, and it's been there for a long time. I don't want to go into technical details of this music, but most of this music is about going into yourself and realizing a different own, our own different worlds. It is basically meditative, but as we have it, there are always two moods in a person. One is a basic mood and one is the excellent mood. Even though if the basic is very meditative and contemplative, the other mood can be what is being expressed at that point of time among the other 8 different moods, like be it Shringhar as in erotic, or be it Shant as in quiet, or be it Rudra as in a very in great depth and very profound. Basically, we begin a piece by a slow portion, a set of notes which is called Raga, and try to connect the notes with different timing interval between them. Each rag has its own character, like its own soul, and we explore different ways of going to the raga, but try to keep the soul intact. It is not the notes only that define a raga. If you say if this raga has so and so notes, so it is this raga. It's not just that. It is something beyond the notes. It is something of timing in between the notes. It is something how you go from one note to another note, how a relationship is formed. It is like sculpting silence. At the same time, it creates its own identity, which is like a knot in the air, which can be felt and seen in the mind, but cannot be experienced, or I mean, sir, cannot be written down. And improvisation is, you take a note, work around it, go to the next note, work around it, go to the third note, work around it, and slowly and gradually. The first portion is called alap. It literally means in Hindi, alap is to stretch. You stretch the note, and in different timings. The second portion is called Jod. Jod means to join in Hindi. And it's the alap which is stretched is joined with a beat, which is not cyclical. Then the Jhala portion, which is a faster portion of the Jod portion, with different kinds of patterns in a rhythmic form. And then finally composition with the Pakhavaj, which is also a very old instrument in India. It is says to have been made by Lord Ganesha. And a very peculiar thing about the Indian drum is that it is tuned to the instrument that or the voice that is going to accompany. This is tuned to G sharp, and so is this instrument tuned to G sharp. If it's tuned to a different note, it will have to be tuned to a different note. So more than just an instrument of rhythm, it is also an instrument of sound. There are long sounds, and when I'm listening to him, though he is keeping a beat, a cyclical beat, but beyond that, there is also a certain kind of flavor to the sound that enhances the music. Here is a tanpura. Tanpura is a drone instrument, has four basic strings. Tan, as in all the notes from Do Re Mi Fa Sol La Ti, and pura means complete. This instrument was invented much later to accompany the main instrument. It gives out a set of overtones. Depending on the rag or the set of notes you want to play, you can tune the tanpura, and a very trained ear can decide what overtones are coming from it. You can pick it up and you can use it with your rag, like complementary or right opposite to it. It sets a certain kind of timing also to the rag. This is the Rudra Veena. Rudra stands for Lord Shiva. He's supposed to have made this really very long time ago. The first proof of this instrument is 236 BC. It's on a gold coin. You have it, a king playing the Rudra Veena. Older than that, there are statues in India. It's a, like you can see, it's a zither instrument. There are two gourds with openings over here. That's where the most of the sound comes out from. Another important thing is there's no flat surface of this instrument. So when you strike a note, it's hollow from here to here. It goes through the stem, comes out through the gourds. Some of it comes out and some of it goes back again. So even though it's a very soft instrument, which was meant only for meditation, and later on it went into chamber concert, but it has long resonating notes. So, and this finally music is a relation of long notes, the feeling of sound, and a structure on basis of which the development of rag is done. Each rag are set to different seasons, different times of the day, and I shall be playing today late evening rag, which is Bihag. Usually in classical concerts, you have a rag which is a set of notes like. And there is an ascending and descending order to it, in which way you should go forward. But our school of thought doesn't believe in that. It believes in the structure, which is a framework, and how you bring her out. Improvisation in the structure without using an ascending and a descending way of the rag, at the same time trying to keep the identity of the rag the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm.